Aman Raina here from Sage Investors, and this is take number 27. One of the more common investing themes or investing principles that are out there is the whole concept, the whole tenet of time in the market is always outdoes timing the market. Essentially, the premise being trying to time the market, pick the exact moments when to buy and pick the exact perfect moments, optimal moments to sell. It just doesn't work over a long period of time. You might get lucky and, you know, throw a dart on the board and you might end up in a good place, but most times than not, it really doesn't help. And fact of the matter is just staying in the market, staying invested is just overlooking when you're looking at probabilities, and that's what a lot of investing is about, is just making educated guesses, looking at probabilities of things happening. Just staying in the market is a lot more lucrative and a lot more profitable. And there's all kinds of data and funky charts out there that to show you. You know, I'll just like throw a few up right now. Here's one chart of the Dow Jones Industrials over the last 130 years. And if you just look at the line, it's literally starting, and this is just to describe the people listening on the podcast here, it literally starts from the bottom left and goes straight up to the top right. And it's just a straight, it looks just like a literally a straight line across. However, this chart's really great because inside this chart too are all kinds of significant socio, political, economic events that have occurred throughout those 130 years. And there's a lot. And the takeaway is if you just ignored all those things, you'd be doing pretty well with in the markets from that perspective, and that those micro minutia details really that we look at from a day-to-day type thing, week to week, month to month, year to year, just really don't make a difference underlying the underlying premise of that the markets go up over a long period of time. So that's one really powerful chart. Second one is the probabilities of you making money the longer you stay invested, the longer your investing time horizons are. And here's one chart of just putting up talking about, like, if you just stayed invested for a month, you'd have your probability of you having more money or growing your savings is about 62%. As you increase that time horizon to up to 15 years, it becomes a 99.8% probability that you're going to grow your savings, that your portfolio is going to grow, your investments are going to grow, which is like literally, you know, guaranteed basically over a long term. Time is your friend. And then finally, you take a look at this one. I always find it interesting that I like to show up to students as if you just took the annual returns of the S&P 500 and just stack them in, you know, in a distribution kind of normal, distribution kind of perspective, you'll see that the S&P 500 just really skews heavily. There's just a lot of green over the last, 100 plus years in terms of investment returns. And there's just a lot less of the red. And as much as we think about market crashes and, 1929 and all those things, those events over the history have been few and far between. And again, if you just stayed in the market, if you just stayed invested, the chances are, and not do any little funny things around it and tinker or tweak your portfolio and things like that, you would probably do pretty well. And so it just all feeds into the whole narrative of just putting your money to work, getting exposure to the markets, and just sticking with it and riding with it. It's ultimately the numbers, the data, history has shown that it'll get you to a good place. And I don't disagree with it. It's pretty clear and pretty easy to see it. The math is clearly showing it to us. The graphics are clearly showing it to us. So why am I talking about this now? Well, I read up, there was an article in Bloomberg last week that we're really talking about the influence that TikTok has. We're seeing this whole advent of financial influencers, finfluencers, and they're really hitting it hard on a lot of the socials. And now TikTok is the latest to get it. You'll see all kinds of posts by a variety of different people, well-versed, not so well-versed in the financial area, in the investing area. And the article is interesting in the sense that it's posted by a university professor and, obviously did some analysis around it. And overall, Their take on it was that, it's, a lot of stuff is dubious out there in the socials, and I do that, and I coach people how to kind of filter out the good and the bad. But overall, and especially, holding on TikTok, that the commentary, the observations, the sharing of information is actually pretty decent with respect to financial investing and investing concepts and principles and things like that. So I found that interesting. But it was a piece in there that talked about, and this is why I bring it back to this whole timing and timing the market versus time in the market, is that the one criticism it did have is it sort of talked to this whole principle of time in the market and said, the drawback of it, of the whole concept of it, is that the longer you stay in the market, the more likelihood of something bad happening in the markets that could negatively impact your portfolio. And that's true. And one of the things I tell when I work with people, when I'm coaching people and I'm teaching people about investing and making decisions, is that you're going to make some bad decisions. There are going to be some bad things that are going to happen. As much as you think you know it all, and as much as you know all the formulas and do all the analysis, something happens. Things will happen that will put pressure on your portfolio, will make the value of your investments go down. It's going to happen. And that one I can tell you with 100% guarantee. And I usually say, if somebody says something is going to happen, usually if somebody says 100% something is going to go up, that's a little bit due. I'm saying there's 100% guarantee you will be experiencing a negative investing moment. We all do. God knows I do. And the whole concept, and this is where time in the market gets really hard. It's right. It's correct. But I think it can really screw you up if you're not very careful. And this is where investing gets really hard. And it's during these moments when the markets aren't doing what you want them to do, when your investments are not going up and you're having just flatlining, it's when investing gets hard. And that's the moments where it's so critical to stay in the market, where you're pressured to kind of get out of your market, or you're pressured to tweak your portfolio, where the bad things can happen. And so it's the hardest thing to do is staying, when those moments happen, is staying disciplined and staying true to your plan, true to your investing playbook, true to your investing ideology. And this is where a lot of people get screwed up, and really this is where investing gets hard. And going back to that Dow Jones, that chart with all the news events and everything, again, you look at it from, you step back and you just look at that line and it's just going straight up. But all, and if you ignore all those news events and things like that that happen to it, it should be good. But the problem is, we're, as people, as human beings, we're just not wired to that. When something bad happens, our instinct is to react, we need to do something. And when those moments happen, it also creates biases. It triggers biases. It triggers doubts in terms of what we're doing. It triggers conflicts in our minds. And it all taps into a core behavior, which we, when we enter those moments, which is a need to do something, to right the ship. Something is not going on in the market. Oh my God, the Dow Jones, the S&P is down, NASDAQ's down, interest rates are going up, and inflation. I have to do something to make my portfolio right so I can withstand that shock. It's interesting. I want to share with you. Yesterday, a couple of days ago, we had the CPI numbers down, and I did a YouTube post on it. The CPI numbers came up and they were really high and the markets just tanked. And that would have been a really interesting pressure point for a lot of people to say, oh my God, inflation rates are staying high for longer, stock prices are going to get done. If you mind map it out, and I was doing that, that is the pressure. And it could make you to do make decisions that you not be comfortable. So guess what happened? The market was down. It was the worst performing day in my portfolios of the year. And I know the year is only not very long. The next day, everything popped back up. So the next day, first day I had when the CPI numbers hit was my worst performing day. The next day was my best performing day in the CPI. What did I do in those periods of time? I did nothing. I just stayed in the market. I didn't try to time anything to make a rash decision. I stayed in the market. And by doing nothing, this is, you know, as much as I talk about time in the market, the kryptonite for time in the market is ourselves, is all the biases and conflicts and little micro news things, micro events that could happen, micro posts by somebody, political things that could trigger us to react to it. And so what the article talks about, the Bloomberg article, saying is that these moments are going to happen, and time in the market is not, may not be such a good deal if, because if you drill down into that chart and with all those news events, sometimes those news events could have implications for not necessarily days, which they talked about just now, but it could last years, it could last decades. And there has been events in history that have shown that. You know, Japan was, you know, the original China. What China is right now is kind of going on with what Japan's going on, like 30 years ago, 40 years ago. It was the company, the country. It had its act together, stock prices, asset prices, super inflated. And then it's just suffered about 30 years and still suffering a malaise of growth in terms of deflation. And the assets, financial assets, just went depressed. Then we had the dot-com issue, debacle in 2000. All the and that had a languishing impact on U.S. Stock prices. We had about a 10-year period where U.S. stocks did nothing. And so the article kind of highlights is trying to make a case saying, you know, time in the market, yes, is ultimately great, but guess what? There will be periods where, you know what, time in the market will mean having to deal with very bad periods of time. And those bad periods could be longer term periods. And so it's easy to say time in the market, just put your money and forget about it. The reality is we're human beings and we are susceptible to a lot of biases and a lot of events and a lot of information, a lot of noise that could potentially make us not be time in the market, make us do things that will prevent us from being in the market and ultimately impact our long-term value of our portfolios. Right now, what we're seeing right now is time in the market from a perspective of that you need to be in the market because of FOMO, because we're seeing like seven stocks driving the whole index right now. And so it's the behavior and the biases that we're going against, that we're fighting right now, is FOMO. Is that you need to be in the market as much as you possibly humanly can because you're missing out. And so the takeaway here is that I want to share with you is that it doesn't matter whether you believe in passive investing, index investing, active investing, buying stocks, buying bonds, whether you're a value investor, a growth investor, you buy ETFs or individual stocks. Investing is hard. And even when you have these principles aware with you, aware of time in the market, doing a lot better versus timing the market, there are going to be pressures on you that are going to challenge your thinking on that, challenge that principle. And it's really hard because we're just not wired that way to deal with it. Time in the market is a very powerful and lucrative and profitable principle to follow. If, and a big if, you're training yourself, you're kind of rewiring yourself to think about investing with a concept of principles. It's important then where having good, strong investing competencies come into play. Ultimately, what does that mean? It's being educated, not just about the mechanical aspects of investing, but the behavioral side of it. Understanding these core principles of time in the market. And then being aware of those stress points when they come into play, which are going to challenge your thinking on that and being able to step aside from those pressures, those conflicts, and those noise that comes out there, and stay true to your ideology, stay true to your core investing principles. And then ultimately, it's practice, constantly engaging in it, constantly building up an awareness, and being able to resist and fight off those biases and behaviors that can come into play. And ultimately, if you're doing what the people that I know that do this really well practiced a lot of this, stay disciplined to their ideology, stay disciplined to these true core investing tenets, time in the market over time, timing the market, it leads to empowerment. It leads to an internal confidence, not a bravado, not a like, look at me. It's more about, hey, I can do this. Hey, I'm on my right path. I feel like I'm on the way to getting to where I need to get to financially. So I found this article very interesting, and I just kind of, it highlighted a really thing that we all do. And as I said, I talk a lot about time in the market. I post it, I write about it, I blog about it, I do videos about it, I teach people about it, I coach people about it. And I make it, it sounds intuitively easy, and the data backs it up. But just always be aware, it's hard to do. It's easier said than done. And I totally get it. And that's one of the things I try to, with my students and with my clients, I try to make sure they understand this tenet and discipline themselves to be aware of these this tenet, and be aware of the potential pitfalls that might take them away from practicing this tenet. Time in the market. Just be in the market. Easier said than done. So that's all I want to share with you today. If you have any questions about this, this little take here, you can hit me up through my website, sageinvestors.ca. You can find me on my, where can you find me? You can find me on LinkedIn, my company page, Sage Investors, is on there. Just do a search for Sage Investors. You can find me on Threads. I'm on there a lot more now than I'm on Twitter. I still call it Twitter. You can do a search for Sage Investors Nations, Sage Investor Nation, on Twitter, on Threads. You can find me on Twitter. I do post stuff randomly around there, but I'm just being straight up. I'm not on there as much now as I used to be. Handle there is Sage Investors. So, and if you want more information about the courses that I teach, the investing courses that I teach, both online and in person and in real time, you can find a lot of information there about my stuff there on sageinvestors.ca. So that's all I got for you. It's been another take of In the Loop. My name is Aman Raina of Sage Investors, and we'll catch you again another time. Take care. Bye-bye.